12, 2016.
The podcast you're about to listen to includes cursing and talking about hoo-haws. Please be advised.
We are the Atheist Nomads, bringing you history, science, politics, religion, and interviews with leaders in the atheist community. Not all those who wander are lost. Welcome to another episode of Atheist Nomads. I am Dustin. Joining me as always is Wesley.
Hello, everybody.
And joining us...
Hello, everybody.
And joining us today is my lovely wife, Lauren.
Hi, everybody.
And our chihuahua, Rocco, who you just heard hit the microphone.
He's so cute.
So, how's everybody doing?
Doing pretty good.
Well, I'm doing great. I started working again.
Working? Fuck yeah.
Yay. Yeah, at my old job with Dustin, actually. So, we're working in the same building now. Yeah, apparently public displays of affection are looked down upon by everybody in the office because going back to work and having your husband there is kind of like being married again for the first time. You're like, hi, honey. Oh, my gosh. Kisses. And it's like, that's not appropriate at all.
Yep. I got talked to by HR.
But I didn't. So I'm considering myself like totally free and in the clear.
Hell yeah.
Sorry, Dustin. I'm going to throw you under that bus. But it is really nice. So I'm familiar with the people. I'm familiar with the job and it's part time. So I'm not doing that stress, angry ball of hatred in my stomach that I was doing for a long time.
Mm.
And money. So money. Yes. Oh my God. Yeah. We're going to be able to breathe again.
Sweet.
It's going to be really sweet. How about you? How about you and Mary, Mary Berry? I'm going to call her Mary Berry now.
Oh, goodness. We've been having quite a bit of fun lately, actually. Can't really say what all we've done.
We've been going out some good food. I noticed that.
Yeah.
Your Facebook feed's full of delicious food. Anyway, are we supposed to be talking about real stuff now? Sorry, I got distracted.
Well, I don't think about food and I'm hungry.
Okay, so we do want to remind everybody that we do have a new app. It is available in both the Google Play Store and the Apple App Store.
Holy shit, yes. Just even if you don't use it, download it, give us a 5-star review, say a few words, and thank you very much.
Yes.
We already have a few 5-star reviews on Google Plays. Not sure about the iTunes because it's, well, fucking Apple.
That's what Mary Berry's for.
Yeah, totally.
Have her check her Apple. Oh,
we are also trying to help raise money for Jolene, the daughter of listener Kyle's coworker, who has eye cancer. And
serious, like eye cancer. That sucks.
Eye cancer and a cute little girl. That's no. She needs help. Their insurance they have at work is kind of shitty, so it's not going to cover all the expenses. So anything we can do to help. Please do. And we are shaking up the format.
Shuka.
This will be our just a couple weeks. We will be hitting the 4-year mark. So we're moving into our 5th season.
Yay!
And with that, we're doing a new format. So, Wesley, what happened today in history?
Oh, this day in history, May 12th, the year 1820. Florence Nightingale, the Italian-English nurse, social reformer, and statistician, was born. Okay. So, Florence was a celebrated English social reformer, statistician, and the founder of the modern nursing. That's kind of cool.
The whole school of thought of nursing, I guess. Yeah.
So, let's go back, way back. Florence, she was... born into a rich, well-connected British family in Florence, Italy. As she grew, her behavior was said to be very exasperating and eccentric, and she had basically no respect for upper-class British women, whom she regarded generally as inconsequential.
Oh! Only their minds. Only their thoughts.
Quite the tomboy, you might say. On the 21st of October, 1854, I'm going to skip around a little bit here. She and a staff of 38 women volunteer nurses that she trained were deployed to Crimea, specifically an area called Scutari. Her team found that poor care for wounded soldiers was being delivered by overworked medical staff in the face of official indifference. Medicines were in short supply, hygiene was being neglected, and mass infections were common, and many of those were fatal. After involving the media, the Times newspaper, in point of fact, the British government sent a prefabricated civilian hospital that basically lowered the death rate to about one-tenth that of the hospital in Scutari. So, yeah, it's kind of cool. By implementing hand-washing and other hygiene practices, and by getting the Sanitation Commission involved, the deaths went even down further. So, holy shit. In 1860, Nightingale laid the foundation of professional nursing with the establishment of her nursing school at St. Thomas Hospital in London. It was the first secular nursing school in the world and is now a part of King's College in London. The Nightingale Pledge, taken by new nurses, was named in her honor, and the annual International Nurses Day is celebrated around the world on her birthday. Her social reforms include improving healthcare for all sections of British society. While better known for her contributions in the nursing and mathematical fields, Nightingale was also an important link in the study of English feminism. During 1850 to 1852, she was struggling with her self-definition and expectations of an upper-class marriage from her family. Seems Florence wrote an 829-page, three-volume work titled Suggestions for Thought to Searchers After Religious Truth. She had it printed privately in 1860, and it was never published in its entirety until recently. An included essay called Cassandra protests the over-feminism of women into near helplessness, such as Nightingale saw in her mother's and older sister's lethargic lifestyle, despite their education.
The constant headaches and the fatigue that a lot of women were. Yeah, they basically had to do that. It was pathetic.
Yeah. She totally rejected their life of thoughtless comfort for the world of social service. Interesting side note, despite being named as a Unitarian in several of the older sources, Nightingale's own rare references to conventional Unitarianism are mildly negative. She remained in the Church of England, the C of E, throughout her life, albeit with unorthodox views, you might say. Florence was influenced early by the Wesleyan tradition and held an intense personal devotion to Christ. The odd bit was that Nightingale believed for much of her life that the pagan and Eastern religions also contained like a genuine revelation.
Whoa.
This made her, this made her completely, it's kind of weird. One of those new ages before it was cool. Fucking hipster.
Well, like the Unitarians.
This made her a strong opponent of discrimination, both against the Christians of other denominations and against those of non-Christian religions. However, she was often critical of organized religion. She disliked the role the 19th century C of E would sometimes play in worsening the oppression of the poor, and Nightingale argued that secular hospitals usually provided much better care than their religious counterparts. So
she's like a total hero, and we love her. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
So if you have a nurse in your life, give them a card for International Nurses Day, because that's Nightingale's birthday, right?
Yeah.
I think so.
May 12th.
Aw.
The day this... Yeah.
Happy International Nurses Day.
And since my parents do listen to the show, Mom, happy International Nurses Day.
Yay! Yeah.
This day in history, the year 1935, Bill W., a.k.a. Bill Wilson, and Dr. Bob Smith meet for the first time in Akron, Ohio, at the home of Henrietta Sieberling, as they found Alcoholics Anonymous.
Alrighty, it's time to dust off the degree. As promised, we can now take a look at the particular spin on Mary that Mexicans take. They call her Our Lady of Guadalupe, or Our Mother of Guadalupe, or the Madonna of Tepeyac. Without even knowing the story, I had known for quite a while that Mexican Catholicism actually looks a lot more like a cult of Mary than it looks like Christianity. And Lauren and I got a decent, albeit very confusing, explanation of this when we were in Mexico on our honeymoon. And this was during the,
The Excaret Especial.
Mexico, no, it was, something. It was a big exposition on Mexico, and we had gay couple sitting next to us who explained all of the details to Lauren that I could not hear over all the noise in there. But then we also saw some other stuff for it. We missed out on the big holiday for her, but we saw Mary everywhere. And so the story really goes back to really the founding of Mexico. There was an Aztec temple for the goddess Tenatzin on Tepeyac Hill. And during the Spanish conquest, so sometime between 1519 and 1521, the temple was destroyed, but people would still come to the site and worship her there. Then, allegedly, on December 9, 1531, a native peasant, whose Spanish name was Juan Diego, was walking up Tepeyac Hill when a woman appeared to him, identifying herself as the Virgin Mary, mother of the very true deity. And this was in his native Aztec language. She asked Juan Diego to build a church in her honor on the hill, and Diego told the bishop, but the bishop didn't believe him. So Diego told her, and she had him keep insisting. Then the next day, he talked to the bishop, and the bishop asked for a miraculous sign. On the way home, he saw the woman for the third time and was told a sign would be given the next day.
So this was actually a pretty cool part of the program where this guy is, he's wandering around and trying to convince all these monks stuff, mm-hmm. and they keep turning away, and he's getting frustrated. He's got something in his pouch, and he's just trying to, like, just listen to me. Just look in the pouch. Just listen to me.
No, we're not to the pouch yet.
Oh, well, anyway.
They had to deny. They had to deny him three times?
Yep.
Three times! But this whole time, there's, like, a big mosaic that's unveiling on the floor. It's pretty cool. Mm.
So the next day, his uncle is very sick, so he didn't go see the operation. Then the day after that, he went to get a priest to administer last rites to his uncle. So he avoided the hill so as to not be delayed, but the Virgin found him anyway and chastised him for not meeting with her the day before.
Joke about Jewish mothers right here.
And she supposedly said something to him like, "Am I not your mother? Do I not care about you?" And then she went and appeared before his uncle and healed him. She then
I'll teach you to interfere.
Yeah.
Healed.
So then she had Diego go up to the top of the hill to collect flowers. Now, normally, this hill in December would be completely bare. This is now a part of a suburb of Mexico City. That is very, very high in elevation. They get cold winters there. And so he goes up there and he finds Castilian roses, which are native to Spain, not Mexico.
Which is also why you see the red rose all over.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're really pretty.
So he collected the roses and he took them to the bishop, rolled up in his cloak. And when he opened it up, there was an image of the Virgin Mary on the cloak. He also told the bishop that she wanted to be called Guadalupe. The bishop kept this private for a few days, but then displayed it in his church. And it got a lot of attention. People really liked it. And then on December 26, it was taken to the hill with a great procession. A church was hastily built, and several people were miraculously healed.
Yeah, and it's the guy sitting next to me... The young gay man who was explaining it to his boyfriend was He explained that there was such great detail in this picture of the Virgin. If you look into in the painting in her eye, you'll see an image of Juan Diego as a reflection in the eye. And that this has been verified by scientists and all this stuff. And I'm like, bullshit.
Yeah. But
anyway.
The Catholic Church doesn't even believe it. The Catholic Church overall has not been favorable towards this. They have tried to push it down, but the people love it. This has become a major symbol of Mexico. And eventually the Catholic Church in 1999 made Juan Diego a saint. But what scientists actually say about the image is that it matches the artistic style of the time period in every way.
Yeah.
Both the style that the Aztecs had been doing before the conquest and the style that the... it has a lot of similarities with that and a lot of similarities with the style that was popular in Spain at the time. And
well, that makes me sad.
Yeah. And all that being said, the church that houses this image is the most visited Catholic pilgrimage site in the world and the third most visited pilgrimage site in the world of any religion.
Wow. So what? It's like Jerusalem and Mecca?
Yep.
Okay.
And
you can't really blame them. I mean,
yeah, there's a lot of Catholics in Mexico.
Besides, I'm sure the food's way better in Mexico than it is in Jerusalem.
What was interesting, the way they told this at Xcaret did not make it clear as to whether or not the people were going up the hill to worship the goddess or Mary. Because the way they kind of portrayed it, they went up to worship the goddess and they all became Catholic and praise the Mother of God. But there's actually a lot of evidence that at least over the next century, many, if not most of the people that were going up to this church to quote unquote honor Mary were actually just going up to worship the goddess.
It's a perfect example of it's like Easter or Christmas. Mm-hmm. To better convert the pagans, take their greatest deity and make it your own. Now, in this case, it was a woman. It was a female figure. They couldn't contribute that to Jesus Christ or God because God is considered a he. Mm-hmm. But what's the next best thing? Mary. So even though the Catholic Church doesn't... I mean, Mary is still pretty high up there. She's not numero uno, but in Mexico, she's definitely like...
Mm-hmm. It's enough that I wouldn't be surprised that if in 100 years, Mexico is not Catholic... It's something, I think it'd be more likely for Mexico to be not Christian and be like Mariist.
Yeah. Yeah. Really? I can see that.
Yeah.
I mean, they've had this around for a few hundred years now. I mean,
oh, if the Catholic Church started to splinter again, I could totally imagine them go their own way. Or if it got too liberal or not liberal enough, or there's all kinds of ways it could happen.
I could totally see that if the Catholic Church splits more.
Oh, yeah. And so in honor of Mexico, I have a shot of tequila, and Lauren has a shot of Zompantun. So cheers.
I've got Barks.
Yay. Mmm. Licorice.
Ooh, yours sounds better.
Ooh, mine?
Yeah.
Well, it helped that I also dashed it with some water. Because the stuff is like syrup. It is
absinthe or ouzo.
It's pretty close. Oof. But this was from a Mayan herb that is licorice tasting.
Mm. It is now time for our first break.
Atheist Nomads is proudly brought to you by Archway Hosting. Check out their low-price, full-featured hosting solutions at archwayhosting.com. That's ARCHWAY hosting.com.
Hey, we're also brought to you by listeners just like you. Find out how you can become a patron at patreon.com/atheistnomads. That's patreon.com/atheistnomads. Yay.
Yay.
And for politics and religion, we're splitting this up into two sections now. Mm. And Wesley's going to start us off.
Oh, boy. So, oh, shit. I just hit my mic. So who's heard about this lovely guy? You might have heard of him. Pat McCrory is the governor of North Carolina. Yeah, you know, him and all those guys over there, I'm pretty sure it's pretty much all guys. Anyways, passed this lovely bill called HB2, House Bill Number 2, which basically went against the Title 12 of the Civil Rights Act.
Oh, yeah, the guy that's getting sued.
Well, it was kind of funny. You know, basically North Carolina passed this law. Then, you know, the Justice Department got involved and, you know, sent a letter off to North Carolina and, you know, gave them some time to respond. And instead of responding, North Carolina just fucking up and sued the Justice Department. And
wow. You
know, yeah. So it was awesome because Loretta Lynch, you know, she's up there and she was like, you know what? No, fuck you. Suing you right back. So, yeah, she just had this amazing speech that she gave, I believe it was yesterday. I highly recommend you guys going out and watching this, first of all. But basically, instead of replying, North Carolina and its governor chose to respond by suing. And thus, we are filing civil rights lawsuit against North Carolina, which more than $800 million in federally backed loans for public universities are at risk if North Carolina refuses to comply with the federal government.
Oh.
And according to Associated Press, of course, but the University of North Carolina system could lose more than $1.4 billion with a B in federal funding.
Damn.
Holy fuck.
It really, really gives you pause when you realize how much of that money this guy's willing to throw away.
I mean, you got businesses left and right. The NCAA just said they're not going to have anything there. I mean, mm-hmm. that's worth tens, if not maybe $100 million, I'm sure, in, you know, people coming there, mm-hmm. spending shitloads of money. Yeah, it's just stupid.
Sounds so, like he's trying to pull an Idaho there.
Ooh.
Do something that will result in a lawsuit.
Yeah.
Just, you know, just take money from the schools and spend it on the lawsuit. Thanks.
Sure, it'll be okay. Yeah, goodness.
Man.
No, I mean, he'll back down and everything will be okay. This will just be a bump, but
it's not as easy as him just backing down, because this is something that was just passed by the legislature. He signed mm-hmm. it into law. Yep. And as far as he sees it, his obligation is to enforce the laws of the state, which is true. He doesn't believe that this is unconstitutional, so it's going to take a judge saying, no, you can't do this, for him to be able to get out of it.
Right. It's exactly what Butch Otter did with the gay marriage.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to read a little bit of what Loretta Lynch read during her speech. Quoting her, "This action is about a great deal more than just bathrooms. This is about the dignity and respect we accord to our fellow citizens and the laws that we, as people and as a country, have enacted to protect them, indeed to protect us all. It's about the founding ideals that have led this country, haltingly but inexorably, in the direction of fairness, inclusion, and equality for all Americans."
Nice.
Holy shit.
I totally imagine like a flag waving, like fading into the background. Maybe America playing in the background. You know, inspiring.
She totally goes on to reference the Jim Crow laws that followed the Emancipation Proclamation, Brown versus Board of Education, and the proliferation of state bans on same-sex unions intended to stifle any hope that gay and lesbian Americans might one day be afforded the right to marry. And she just like, bam, 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 just like, fucking, you know what? All these other times, yeah, all you fuckers, all you crackers were on the wrong side of history. You're on the wrong side this time.
Yeah, it's not like, I mean, we didn't even have time to catch our breath after sex marriage was approved for this to happen.
I know.
It's like, okay, well, who else can we pick on? Oh, T. What does the T stand for? We don't like them either.
Aw. Well, we're Americans. Nobody likes tea. We drink coffee. Fuck tea.
All right. Well, Roy Moore, we're sticking with the South for now. Roy Moore is
that
the
lovely man.
Alabama Chief Justice who has attempted to nullify the U.S. Supreme Court ruling allowing same-sex marriage. He has told the state's probate judges to ignore federal orders to comply with that ruling. And he was removed from the same office in 2003 for refusing to comply with a federal court order to remove a Ten Commandments monument that was out in front of the Alabama Supreme Court building.
Then those fuckers voted him right back in.
Yeah, 2012.
Well, that's because those fuckers believe in the same thing, whether it's constitutional or not. They think he's right. And that's why Idaho says, thank God for Alabama, because if it weren't for them, we'd be down there at the bottom of the list.
Ooh.
Well, on Friday, he was suspended with pay when the Alabama Judicial Inquiry Commission forwarded charges of violating judicial ethics to the Alabama Court of the Judiciary. And if he is found guilty, he will again be removed from office.
And at that point, I would certainly hope that he's not reelectable, that people would finally realize that.
Everyone thinks he's going to run for governor again.
Okay. Go for it, Alabama. It's not like you can do any worse.
Yes, they can. They can. This is Alabama. Okay. They can do much worse. Tony Yarbrough is the mayor of Jackson, Mississippi. And he is also the pastor of the Reverent Empowerment Church. Last year, he tweeted, yes, I believe we can pray potholes away. Moses prayed and the sea opened up. Hashtag, I see ya. Hashtag, I trust him. Hashtag, prayer works.
Hashtag, bullshit.
And more recently, he filmed and this week released a public service announcement called We Are Jackson, where he is showing city employees filling potholes.
Oh, see? It works.
It does.
If you go with an older meaning of pray, like, you know, medieval, I pray ye do whatever.
Oh.
Meaning ask. Yes, you can ask the potholes away. The mayor has the power to ask city employees to fucking fill them.
Well, it's perfect, right? Because he gets the potholes filled and his revelation came true, right? So it's not like he... Like, for a crazy person, it works.
But it's not a miracle if you have the power to do it yourself normally.
Well,
I don't think he's considered it's a miracle, but he prayed for them to go away, and with a little bit of elbow grease, that got them to go away.
That's like saying, I could pray for this podcast to get edited,
and then I sit down
and do it. No, I just sit down and do it.
Well, glory be to God, you edited it.
Only if the unedited version is truly a horrendous thing on the populace. It's like, I pray that he edits this one. I pray that he does. And if he does, look at that, my prayer came true. That's how most prayers are. Self-fulfilling prophecies. Gosh, I pray that so-and-so gets better. They go to the hospital, they get better. Yeah, it wasn't the prayer that did it, but go ahead and pat yourself on the back.
We love hearing from our listeners. You can email us at contact@atheistnomads.com, tweet us @atheistnomads, send us a message on our Facebook page at facebook.com/atheistnomads, or better yet, call us and leave us a message at 541-203-0666. We might even play it on the show. You can also help us out by leaving us a review on iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcast directory of choice. We're now moving into the international news section. In 2013, Saudi Arabia began allowing girls in private schools to engage in PE classes and sports activities as long as they dressed in a way that complied with the Saudi interpretation of Sharia. Now girls across the country are demanding that this rule be expanded to all schools across the kingdom. And the Saudi education ministry has said that it has not made a decision on the matter. Because what teenager doesn't want to have to exercise in a very hot desert wearing tons and tons of clothing?
Yeah, I think there were, what is it, long sleeve shirts and long pants?
And heads covered.
I think that's it. I think that the new...
Head coverings are still included.
Yeah. But that's part of the new rules. The old rules were a lot more strict.
So kind of like wear 50s PJs plus a headscarf.
The old rules is girls can't do PE or play in sports. What Baby they're steps. Wanting is to be able to wear those Sharia compliant, you know, everything but your face and hands is covered.
Sure.
Yeah, 50 style pajamas with little footies, but they have to have sticky bottoms.
So long as they have the little butt buttons, so you can have the little butt flap. Yes.
And what is important to note here? These girls want PE enough that they are willing to wear that kind of clothing for it.
Well, yeah.
They just want to be able to play in PE class. Now, there is some concern that it might turn them into a decadent, sin-filled place like Kuwait.
Damn, Kuwait. You crazy.
Oh, Kuwait.
And
moving on
April 22, Ambreen, a 15-year-old Pakistani girl, helped her neighbor elope with her boyfriend. The neighbor's boyfriend, not Ambreen's boyfriend. A few days later, a 15-member tribal council met to investigate the elopement and ruled that Ambreen's actions, that is, helping her neighbor and friend, had brought dishonor and ordered her death. Some members of the council then strangled her and tied her to the back seat of a van, which they then set on fire. The girl's charred remains were found on April 29, and police have arrested the girl's mother, who they think knew about the plan, and 13 council members. It is worth noting that last year, more than 1,100 women were killed by relatives in honor killings, just like this in Pakistan.
Gotta say, at least they, like, killed her before they torched the van.
I don't know. Being strangled is pretty awful. Of course, not like being burned alive, but
yeah.
And they strangled her with ropes.
It doesn't. Yeah, it's bad.
That's not an easy way to die.
Yeah, yeah. That whole women is.
I'll still take that over burning alive.
I'm surprised there aren't more infanticides in cultures like that, where if you give birth to a girl, they just kill the baby right off the bat.
Well,
to prevent these kind of things. They're just going to end up killing her anyway.
Yeah, but the logic doesn't work out that way. The innocent baby you can't kill. It's not until she does something wrong.
That plus it's a really good way to tie families together. And
it's insane that 1,100 women last year alone. The police are attempting to crack down in this particular case that got international attention. The overall thought on it, though, is that the police do not take this seriously and that they don't do much. But frankly, most of this is happening in tribal regions in Western Pakistan where the government has very little, if any, control.
I was going to say, it took them a whole week to get around to it, to the arrest.
You know, I could see them arresting the mother just because, fuck it, she's a woman. But even arresting 13 guys is, holy shit, that's surprising to me. Let them off.
They arrested 13 of the 15 total number of council members. This is the Council of Tribal Elders.
Yeah.
And they hauled off almost the entire council.
That takes brass buttons.
Yeah.
It also leaves a huge power vacuum, right, where, you know, it's probably not needed.
There's the civil government there. The tribal council is not any kind of legal authority.
No, it's the community authority, though.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, moving on.
The MacArthurs of Asher's Bakery in Belfast, Northern Ireland, are appealing a court ruling from last year that they had discriminated against Garth Lee in refusing to bake a cake with a pro-gay marriage message and Bert and Ernie from Sesame Street.
Aww.
The complaint and the ruling against them was that they discriminated against Garth Lee because he's gay. The MacArthurs claimed that his sexual orientation was irrelevant and that they would have refused to make a cake with that message or any other message they found sinful, regardless of the person's orientation. And this is different than the cake cases we've seen in the U.S. in that this was a cake ordered by an activist, presumably for a meeting or a rally, not by a couple for their wedding.
It sounds like he went out of his way to try and piss this couple off. It's just like, hey, I'm going to go and I'm going to totally make them put this on a cake. And if they said don't, I'll just claim the discrimination because I'm gay. He sounds like a little asshole. But
it kind of seems that the baker should have less ground to stand on with this because it's not a marriage. It's just a slogan or a saying.
They don't have to
celebrate the joining of two men in holy matrimony.
I see it the exact opposite way. If it's wedding cakes have a very basic, simple formula. And written on it is usually the couple's names and the date and not much else. So right.
with a guy and a guy on top or a girl and a girl on top.
So realistically, that doesn't matter. You're not conveying a message. You're writing names on a cake. At the point of actually putting a message on it, I can see allowing bakers to not do that.
It happens here all the time. You are not allowed to go to Albertsons, Fred Meyer, Safeway, and say, hi, I want to put a fuck you on this cake with a picture of, you know, somebody flipping something off. A cake decorator can say, I'm not going to do that. You can't just say, you're discriminating against me because I'm gay. Or because you happen to be gay. Or you happen to be black. Or you happen to be something else. That's not how that works. But so, depending on what the message was, I can totally see this being overblown. But if it was a simple...
If it was a quote-unquote pro-gay marriage message, I mean... I doubt that it's like, you know, fuck straight people.
Or it's probably not censorable at all. It was probably fairly innocent, like love for all or something. But
plus that Bert and Ernie, you know, you can't have Sesame Street come out
and officially proclaim that Bert and Ernie are not gay.
But when
they have gay characters, and they are not gay.
There is a big difference between.
Just for your information,
I call bullshit on that.
There's a big difference between asking somebody to put John and Jim together forever on a cake.
But that's the whole thing that the Christians in the U.S. at least are fighting against, is that, you know, they say once you put John and Jim and two little guy statues on there, that you're sanctioning their wedding, that you're approving it also.
Which, that's bullshit, because...
It is.
It's a business of public accommodation. All of the same arguments were applied with interracial marriage. And if you refuse to give that person service for their wedding cake, they can't get a wedding cake if you're in a small town or a really conservative area. And where I see this one as being different is activist messages, I don't think deserve protection.
I really want to know what this message was.
Right? It all depends on the message.
I only followed it through one link, and I didn't get to what it actually was.
I bet you it was something really innocuous.
Yeah, something about love for everyone or something like that. We've seen lots of signs and stuff that work for that. But the fact that this guy was doing, I don't know, it just sounds to me like this guy was really trying to get their goat and like set this all up anyway. Like he knew that this was going to happen. And no, they did not discriminate against him for being gay. I don't think that that argument stands.
No, they... I wouldn't say that they... You know, the judge's ruling was that they did. They had knowledge the plaintiff was gay. But...
Okay, the message was support gay marriage. With Bert and Ernie.
Okay, so as a business owner, I would just say this does not necessarily reflect my personal beliefs, but it's income.
As a business owner, I'd say give me your money and yeah. I'll make you a cake.
This, if it said support segregation, do you think a cake maker should have to make that cake?
Yeah, that's the blurry line of freedom of speech. Are people allowed to have parades that say, you know, take out?
That's different.
This
a parade is not asking anybody to write your message.
I guess I personally don't find it ethically. That it ethically invalidates my own beliefs by writing or parroting somebody else's words. And if it does, then the really shallow beliefs. It's like, really? You know you don't believe in it, but it's income, and if you don't do it, you'll get in trouble.
There's a line where I think you wouldn't do it.
Oh, there is always a line, yeah. But, oh well. I mean, I probably wouldn't have... You're talking about segregation, though.
You know what? My line would be: you're talking about segregation, though, and your line—that was your—that was your question. Would you write a pro-segregation line?
Mm-hmm.
And one, no, and two, because it's against the law.
No, it's not.
It's not.
If you wanted a cake that said segregation forever, that's not against the law. And if you do want to go with that's against the law as an argument, in Northern Ireland, marriage equality is against the law. Gay marriage is illegal there.
Hmm. Okay, with that in...
Deep discussion.
I think of segregation as schools and such like that, and that is actually against the law.
But messages promoting something that is illegal is not in and of itself illegal.
Right. It just makes you an
asshat. As far as Ireland goes without a marriage equality on the books.
Northern Ireland.
Northern Ireland. What did I say?
Ireland.
Oh, okay. Well, Northern Ireland, goodness, still, I guess that the baker has more leeway there, but still definitely on the wrong side of history.
Yes.
And I think that should be kind of a moral compass for you.
Well, the big difference here is that it was done by an activist, not by the couple actually getting married. It sounds like it wasn't even a wedding cake. It was just a cake.
Mm-hmm.
Did their actions reflect discrimination against the person, or was it their own personal beliefs that they were protecting? And in this case, the guy claiming that they didn't do it because he was gay is, I don't think, a valid argument here. Because they may not have had prior knowledge that he was gay. They probably did.
The judge says that there's every reason to think they did, which leads me to assume this guy would probably trigger anybody's gaydar.
There's also the argument that if you're making enough money that you can afford to refuse services to people, that's allowed everywhere. To a certain extent. You're right, in small rural communities where there's the one lonely cake maker who has to, you know, make cakes for everybody equally. This isn't that case. You know, this person could have gone anywhere for a cake. You chose this place in particular.
It could be that he went somewhere else. It could be that you're assuming he chose that place specifically, but it could just be that was the closest bakery.
Yeah, that's true. I just remember in college we used to have discussions like this where it was like, oh yeah, I heard so-and-so's. It was like, there's a place here that serves fish and chips. Best fish and chips in town. The person also happens to think that gay marriage is sinful and won't serve food to gay people if they're openly gay. So we were thinking of all sorts of things to try and tie them into, you know, oh man, how can you catch this guy and get him sued? It is within the realm of possibility that these people did the exact same thing, only followed through with it instead of just talked about it.
And the Asher's Baking Company, which is the bakery, Asher's is named after one of the 12 sons of the biblical patriarch Jacob. They are definitely a very Jesus-y company.
Ah. Now, one...
They should just throw out the whole thing.
One angle I do want to also bring up is, do we all agree that minority groups deserve protection from discrimination?
Yes.
Yeah.
Should that protection be potentially overly reactionary and defer to assuming that it is discrimination?
Yes.
At first, I would have to say yes. You have to have the knee-jerk reaction at first in order to get the ball rolling. Does that make sense?
Then this ruling was correct.
Yeah, because sometimes you have to overprotect the minority at first before they can stand on their own feet. And that seems to be the case in Northern Ireland, where there's laws that make it illegal, so they're going to do everything they can to stay in the papers. It's like getting arrested at any protest, you know. People don't go there to say... Some people go to protest saying, I'm going to do what I can to get arrested because this, I don't want this fight to die.
Fucking Democracy Spring in D.C. They had the most people arrested ever to basically talk about citizens getting money out of politics. Citizens United. So that was their purpose going there, was to get arrested and to, you know, get in the news, make this known.
So while I think this guy was being an asshat, he was doing it with a heart of gold. Anyway.
All right. That is it for news. It is time for our last break and then science and technology.
We're moving on to science and technology. Today, we are going to be speaking of a couple of recent news items that are near and dear to my heart. First off, those of you who missed Mercury's transit, shame on you. It was super cool. I watched it live on my phone while I was laying in bed. And sorry, what was that?
I totally missed it.
Oh, well, It only happens once in a while. I remember it happening back in college, and everybody had the big sun scopes out, and it was really cool. So I got to watch it on the space.com's live feed.
Nice.
While maintaining the outer space / astronomy link, I'm going to also discuss what NASA announced today. Oh my gosh, this is so exciting. Today being Tuesday, at a news conference this afternoon, NASA revealed that the Kepler Space Telescope has discovered an additional 1,284 exoplanets.
God damn.
That increases the known entities up to 3,200. So just a little less than half. They went up, they basically jumped it like 100, almost 100%. Pretty freaking amazing.
Wow.
A couple key discoveries that are involved in that is, of those planets, the 1,200 planets, 1,300 planets, 9 showed elements of being habitable by, you know, with life. Hmm. Not with life, but could be habitable for life.
As we know it.
As we know it. So that Goldilocks zone plus rocky plus oxygen equals these 9 out of 1,300 planets. I put 3 up on my hand and I don't know why. 9 of those planets. fingers are hard, people, for those of you watching on YouTube. So this raises the total of habitable planets up to 72. So it's not quite as big of a jump, but the fact that they were able to get that huge amount of planets out just most recently is pretty amazing. People were all abuzz on the social medias yesterday saying, they have a big announcement. They have a big announcement. What's it going to be? Like, Kepler owns space. It's pretty awesome. They also confirmed the telescope's previous findings that the majority of planets in the Milky Way are probably rocky Earth-like planets. So of everything that they've documented, I forget exactly how many it was, the 1,300 rocky Earth-like planets were the majority of those found. So
that
ups our chances of finding habitable zones and habitable planets, and is this just really super cool considering that funding for Kepler was supposed to have gone away several years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that it is still running. It's kind of, you know, they did it right. Back in the day when they made Kepler and Hubble, they made these things to last only a couple of years, and they've managed to last way longer than anybody could have guessed.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been nothing but a boon for us as a scientific and technological civilization. So, super cool. The next thing, we're going to go the opposite this way. Instead of going out into space, we're going to go deep into the ocean. Some of you may have seen some videos or pictures released from NOAA. I can't remember what it stands for. NOAA.
National Oceanographic and Astronomical Agency.
Yeah, something like that. It's really cool anyway. They're in charge of mapping oceans. Anyway, they've been releasing videos of, say, glow-in-the-dark jellyfish or sea slugs that are swimming in the water. This is all coming from their craft known as Okeanos, like Keanu, but not quite. Okeanos. And this is part of a very thorough mapping of the Mariana Trench that has been going on for just a couple months. They've updated their website to have live feeds on everything from their instrument panels to their cameras, to their wet lab and their dry lab. So you can actually go onto oceanexplorer.noaa.gov and look at all these live feeds as they're going around the Mariana Trench right now. It is really cool. The highlights are obviously kind of compiled into YouTube videos and such, but for the most part, you're going to see a lot of dark, murky stuff. What makes this so important is that this is the single deepest trench on our planet, found, in case you didn't know, the western part of the Pacific Ocean near Guam.
Mm-hmm.
We've known about it for years. It was first, first measured back in the 1850s. So it's not like it's news, and it's been studied extensively, but we still know almost nothing about it. especially any kind of life that lives there.
It's hard as hell getting shit down there to actually mm-hmm. stay functioning.
Yeah, imagine an entire little laboratory living down there. It's like sea lab or something.
With that kind of pressure, though, man.
The pressure is killer. That's why uh-huh. they haven't been able to get down there before now. We finally have the technology and the ability to actually go down to those deep pressures. And what they're finding is amazing. They were expecting to find a couple of those xenoforms, you know, the bacteria that live in volcanic...
Extremophiles.
Yeah. Xenoforms and extremophiles. No, I'm not thinking xenomorphs.
Okay.
That is science fiction. No, this is a term I picked up somewhere looking around today.
Throw forward. Like,
yes?
Science fiction. Throw forward.
You lost me.
The podcast we're going to be doing?
What does throw forward mean?
Kind of that we're going to mention
in the future.
Yeah.
Oh, ah, yay.
Yeah.
That's true. But anyway, this is going to be their first really huge extensive mapping of the Mariana Trench and also documenting what life forms they come across. So recently, I would say 2 years ago, they released basically an encyclopedia of all life found on the oceans thus far. It's amazing. And if you can find it online, do it because it's got everything. Well, no, it doesn't because we're finding new stuff. So this is just all, it's just really cool. Check out the live feeds, check out the videos that they've released, including the jellyfish, the vents, and the sea slugs and stuff. Or just go follow the live feed at oceanexplorer.noaa.gov. And that's it for science and technology for today. Science!
For feedback, we got a comment on Facebook on episode 144. From Pat Miller. Brondo, it has electrolytes plants need.
God damn right it does. See, new people like that.
I don't know what Brondo is.
The paper towels.
There's a movie called Idiocracy. You need to watch it. That has to go on your short list.
Oh.
Ah.
Okay, yes.
About a man and woman, IQ 100, that get frozen in this army experiment that gets all forgotten about, and a couple hundred years later, they get woken up, and they're magically the smartest people in the world by far.
Hmm.
Oh, that does sound awful.
It's made by Mike Judge, who made Beavis and Butthead. Trust me.
And King of the Hill.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, we want to hear more, even if we don't get the references.
We just got another iTunes review on my birthday, of all days, April 28th. 5 stars from Peace Be Upon Him. It's fun, like informative, and well thought out. It has an audio and video format, has great conversation, and I love their down-to-earth style. It's two or sometimes three friends getting together to have a conversation about atheism and other related issues. It will round out your playlist.
Aw, and it's peace boo upon him.
Peace be.
Boo.
No, be upon.
It's the letter B, so I'm...
Peace boo upon him.
Yes. Peace boo upon him.
All right.
Anyway, yes, keep those reviews coming. Please let us know how you like the app, because, we have an app. That's awesome.
We got two.
Check us out on Google.
Shame.
Rate us on there too, because that's the new big thing that just got rolled out like the past couple weeks. So we need to up the excitement on that one.
Fuck yeah!
And we got a new patron.
We love patrons.
Bumbleclot.
Thank you, Bumbleclot. You rock, man.
And thank you for the awesome name that we get to say on the air, Bumbleclot.
All right, if you want to get a hold of us, you can always email us at contact@atheistnomads.com, call us at 541-203-0666, hit us up on iTunes, YouTube,
Google,
or wherever you can.
Google Play, the Play Store, and the iOS App Store, and Patreon, and give us money.
Hey, guess what? Bumbleclot means toilet paper.
Bumbleclot, we love you.
Ooh, and Wesley's got something.
What's he got there? Yeah.
I just got a Wacom tablet. So if you guys
Bitch.
Yeah, it'd be really nice if you guys, you know, kick me a few bucks, but I'm gonna start working on our graphics so we can get our t-shirt going, and you know, because I want to happen.
One of those. I'm doing a coloring book,
and I want them.
I'm doing lots of coloring books, and I want I should do a coloring book of awesome atheist secular science people.
Yeah,
I need to work on my people. Florence Nightingale, you totally hit the front page. All right. All right, girl.
All right. Next week, we'll be back with another interview. So thank you all for watching and or listening. You guys rock.
Thank you for listening to another episode of Atheist Nomads. You can find show notes and contact information at atheistnomads.com. Follow us on Twitter at Atheist Nomads. And like us on Facebook at facebook.com/atheistnomads. Please subscribe to the show in iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcatcher of choice. And while you're there, feel free to leave us a review. Theme music is courtesy of Sturdy Fred. Until next time, this has been the Atheist Nomads.